What would you be willing to do in order to protect the planet? As fears about climate change have grown, we've heard a wide variety of by now familiar proposals. Maybe we should shift over to renewable energy sources. Maybe we should tax carbon. Maybe we should stop eating meat. Maybe we should use balloons to fill the stratosphere with chemicals to block out the sun. Maybe we should... Wait, what was that last one? In recent decades, the world has been on a crusade to reduce carbon emissions. And here's the most important thing to know about that crusade. It hasn't worked. Despite the international treaties, the annual conferences, and the trillions of dollars invested in clean energy, global CO2 emissions have continued a largely uninterrupted rise. In 2022, humans put over 37 billion metric tons of CO2 into the atmosphere, nearly 65% more than we did 30 years earlier. And look, by now, we all pretty much know the reactions those facts will generate. Some people will say this just shows we have to redouble our efforts on things like renewable energy. Some people will say, who cares? Climate change isn't a real problem anyway. Some people will say that we need to start focusing more on adapting to a changing climate. But also, and this one you probably haven't heard before, some people will say, forget about changing the environment by accident. Let's start changing it on purpose. And despite how that may sound, some of these people are serious enough that it's probably worth understanding exactly what they're talking about. This, for instance, is Paul Crutzen with his fellow Nobel Prize winners. Crutzen, who won the Nobel in Chemistry for his work on the ozone layer, was one of the people most responsible for mainstreaming the concept known as geoengineering, the idea that humans can intentionally change the weather in order to mitigate the worst potential effects of climate change. Now, if you think this sounds crazy, you should know that Professor Crutzen, who died in 2021, kind of agreed. Even he didn't think it was an ideal solution, and he acknowledged that there could be plenty of potential risks. His argument, though, was that since nothing else is making a difference, there might not be any better alternative. In practice, there are two primary forms of geoengineering. The first method is called carbon capture, literally pulling some of the extra carbon dioxide back out of the atmosphere. There are lots of ways this might work, from direct air capture machines that filter the air to genetically modifying plants to suck up more carbon. Perhaps the most movie villain version is that if you fertilize the ocean with enough iron, you can spur algae blooms so massive that they'll suck enough carbon out of the atmosphere to cool the planet. Now, we know what you're saying, this all sounds good, but we need something weirder. Well, you're in luck, because the other flavor of geoengineering is blocking out the sun. Just a little bit. It's called geosolar engineering, and the idea is to slightly brighten the atmosphere to reflect more of the sun's energy back into space. That means less heat trapped below, which means less warming. It's not intended as a cure so much as a way to stabilize things until we find a better alternative. And here's the thing, this is all surprisingly plausible. The chemicals involved are cheap and incredibly efficient. There are several potential delivery mechanisms, from ships pumping out mist to brighten clouds, to bursting thousands of weather balloons filled with sulfur dioxide in the stratosphere, to jumbo jets pumping it out the back. And perhaps most surprisingly, none of this costs that much. At least by the standards of, you know, altering the planet. The total expense would be about the same as what it takes to run an airline. Okay, maybe not Spirit. But here's the catch about geoengineering. While the science might be slightly easier than it sounds, all the other issues are likely to be way harder. After all, who gets to make these decisions for the entire planet? And what happens if not everyone agrees? What if the US and Europe launched a carbon capture program? A major carbon emitter like China might just decide that gives them permission to emit even more. What if we engaged in geosolar engineering? Even if it worked, the effects wouldn't be evenly distributed around the globe. Who's responsible if, say, we accidentally push India, the world's most populous nation, into a massive drought, which is a scenario that experts say could really happen? But here's the trickiest part about geoengineering. Even if every country got on the same page regarding this technology, the science is so straightforward that even rogue individuals could start fiddling with the climate. In fact, that's already happened. In 2012, a businessman working with a small town on Canada's west coast dumped 100 metric tons of iron sulfate into the Pacific in the hopes that it would trigger an algae bloom and help increase the region's salmon population. That got him condemnation from environmental groups around the world, but it also led to a plankton bloom that covered 10,000 square kilometers. So, what does the future look like? Actually, it may be more straightforward than it seems. Amongst experts, there's a pretty universal consensus on two points. Number one, there are way too many unknowns for us to seriously consider geoengineering at this point. And number two, it's vital that we do more research so that we can understand geoengineering's potential and its limits. That's why everyone from the federal government to Harvard to Bill Gates is now supporting more and better studies. Will it work? Who knows? But remember, many great ideas start out sounding crazy because they're so revolutionary. And lots of others sound that way because they're actually insane.